Berks Community Health Center Presents on BCTV is supported by the Berks Community Health Center.
Hi, and welcome to Berks Community Health Center Presents. I'm Mary Ellen Marr Harkins. I'm the Director of Compliance at Market and Marketing at Berks Community Health Center. Thank you for being here with us. We really are at a new time now. We're in the evenings. We used to be on in the middle of the day, so we decided we need to reach out and talk to more folks during the evening. We have a real interesting and kind of special show tonight. I love doing these shows. It's about Gift of Life, the organ donation program in Pennsylvania. And I'm going to go down the line and introduce everybody who's here. Starting on the far left is Dwendy. Dwendy Johnson is the community relations supervisor of the Gift of Life program in PA. Or
thanks
this region?
From the region, for Eastern the region. PA.
Yes, mm-hmm. So thank you. Bruce Edwards is a Womelsdorf resident. And Bruce, you are a donor dad, and right. You are also a recipient. So we'll get in and tell your story. Okay. And Jake Hafer is a heart transplant recipient and has been for many, many years now. So we want to hear your story, too. So thank you for being here with us. This is really, it's such an important show. It's real important for people to know about organ donation. So I'm going to let Wendy talk a little bit about what organ donation means in the community and to people, and maybe just give us a sense of, are people waiting for organ donations in our region and our state? Mm-hmm. Tell us about what it really means.
Sure. So I work for an agency called Gift of Life Donor Program, and we're the region's organ procurement agency. So we are the liaison between someone has donated an organ to someone that is going to be receiving an organ. So we're hoping that everyone in the community thinks about organ donation and educates themselves about how they could actually help save more lives. We know that in just our region alone, we're looking at over 5,400 people of variety of age that are in need of a life-saving solid organ transplant today. And if we can just have one person register at the driver's license or say yes to organ donation, they could help save well over 8 people's lives through organs and also enhance the lives through tissue as well. Tissue meaning corneas or bone or skin, saphenous veins or even heart valves that could actually enhance someone's life.
Yeah, that's kind of amazing because I think for many years people just thought of a heart transplant or a lung transplant, and it's grown so much to be so many more things. Mm-hmm. Now, Bruce, you said you got a cornea transplant 30 years ago.
Over 30 years
ago. Was that uncommon then? Was it common?
No, that was common at the time, and I still believe to this day there's more cornea transplant than all other organs combined, although it's not technically an organ. But it's a life-enhancing operation, not a life-saving one, but I mean it definitely affected my life. I was a young state trooper, and the irony of it is we used to transport the eyes at night. That was back when the transports from the mortuary, the funeral homes directors, they actually would remove them, pack them in ice and in styrofoam, and during the midnight shift we would be relaying them down to Will's Eye Hospital, which is where I had my operation. But my job would have been restricted. I would have been on non-police duty. I would have been inside. I mean, there's jobs for us. I wouldn't have lost my job, but I would not have been able to do what I love to do and continue my career as I had without the operation.
And for you, Jake, you got a heart when you were how old?
I was 7 months old when I had my heart transplant.
So you were not aware you needed a heart transplant when you were 7 months old.
I don't have no recollection of what, I only learned about my transplant through my parents. From what I've been told over the years, that I had what's called a hypoplastic left heart syndrome, mm-hmm. which is when the left portion of the heart is underdeveloped. And there were some other complications, but the cardiologist knew that I need surgery fast.
Mm-hmm. Now, I think, so your story, I think your mom was kind of filling me in a little bit, since you were You were not there remembering it. And you actually, you were able to wait a little bit longer to get your transplant because many children with that birth defect die very, very young. They don't make it. So you had a little shunt going on there in your heart that was able to, you know, keep your heart going for a while. I'm curious, so you don't, you're growing up, you don't know that you had a heart transplant. This is just my body, my heart. I'm sure it wasn't a secret. But when did you start to become aware of how important it was, what had been able to, you know, that you were able to get this heart transplant?
I guess I always knew that I became aware that it was special. I just didn't acknowledge it as I guess I should have. Like, over the years, when I was growing up, my parents always told me that I just had a transplant, and then I have all these, like, newspapers and stories about me, but then you don't really understand it until you grew up and then you hear about all these different stories of other people who had similar surgeries and heart transplants, and you realize how special what my surgery had been.
And when you imagine, I mean, a heart transplant is somebody lost a child and was able to be so brave to give, you know, to kind of deal with that and confront that. Now, Bruce has dealt with that yourself.
Yes, I said the interesting thing, my journey started way back when I got my corneal transplant, but unfortunately, just over 10 years ago, our 17-year-old daughter was killed in a car accident. And one of the things, again, on educating people, we were only able to donate tissue, but the tissue, today, one tissue donor can enhance the lives of up to 70 people. And it's tremendous of where they've been able to go with tissue, whether it be bone, skin, ligaments. A lot of kids now, their knees are being rebuilt, sports injuries, with cadaver ligaments, which are much better than the way they used to reproduce them. Burn victims, having real skin. All these things that make a difference. And heart valves, natural heart valves, which is better than an artificial heart valve, can go in and help somebody. But she was killed at the scene of the accident, so the tissue can still be donated. But anybody who's planning on donating an organ, when I say planning on it, unless you're a live donor, it's not that you plan on it, but you sign up in case the unthinkable happens. You have to actually die in a hospital under a situation where your organs continually receive oxygen. So you've sustained some type of massive injury, usually to the head, but not always. Duane, you can probably speak better on that. And then a lot of these people become brain dead, where the machines are keeping their body functioning, but they really are—they're past. They're not with us anymore.
So for me, I have a little organ donor thing on my driver's license. I'm getting on in years. Is there an age limit?
There actually is no age limit. No.
Seriously.
In the country, there has been recipients that received at the age of 94, and they were able to donate too at that age. So we always tell people, if that is what you so desire and that you want to help save a life, register. Tell your family members.
Well, and especially now, knowing that there's so many, I mean, I do believe there are parts of us that kind of wear out that might not be super useful to people, you know, when you're really older. But with corneas, with tissue, with all of
the one she was talking about, the oldest donor, it was a liver. Your liver regenerates.
Really?
And I think we just heard recently, your liver actually has a lifespan. A healthy liver could live like 160 years or whatever.
Wow.
So that 90-some-year-old man donated a liver. And because it regenerates, getting to the other side of my story, I'm a donor dad two times now. In November, my son donated half of his liver, one of his lobes, to a coworker who would have eventually died if she did not receive a liver transplant. Since your liver regenerates, His grew back to full size, although he only has one lobe now. You can only do it once, you can't do it again. And she has the other lobe, and that grew to the full normal size inside of her. And both of them are doing extremely well, so it was very positive. But most people know you can donate a kidney because you only need one and you have mm-hmm. two, but you also can donate a portion of your liver, which again, it's a very amazing organ because it processes all the toxins out of your body.
Yeah.
But one of the things you were starting to ask Wendy, the number of people on the list and the number dying every day in our state and in the country, mm-hmm. Is just amazing.
What is that number?
There's 20 people a day that die waiting off of that list. So keeping in mind that, you know, we register, 98% of the people that register to be organ donors do it at the driver's license center mm-hmm. and at the time. So it's really important to think about that it really takes a perfect storm for someone actually to be an organ donor
mm-hmm.
When they pass away. So they could help save multiple lives. One person today could help save over 8 lives through organs, and then with tissue, over 70 lives through tissue donations. So it is a gift and a legacy that we can give that lives on in others. And the fact that, you know, depending on the circumstances of someone's death, this could be a good thing, you mm-hmm. know, something good out of such a terrible tragedy that yeah. they're able to leave that legacy to save someone's life.
Well, I think, Jake, that was really a situation that the family had to face, you know, for you to receive your heart. But you're how old now?
I'm 22 years old right now.
Is that kind of remarkable?
I suppose so. I mean, when I was young, my mom, she had the fact that from one of the surgeons, that they told her that.
How long were you expected to live when you had the transplant?
10 years old, and I'm...
You're 22 now. And then did that number keep going up? Did they say, oh, well, you've hit 10, now we can expect you to live to 18 or 20? Did you have these intermediate steps?
None that I know of.
No, well, that's good. Now, what's your life expectancy now, do you think?
I don't think I have a life expectancy as of now.
Related to the transplant, I don't mean just, you know, have doctors said, you know, mm-hmm. is there a limit?
No, I don't think so, no. In my experience.
Yeah. Have your doctors told you that you're healthy and you don't have to worry about the heart transplant issue?
Other than having my medicine, mm-hmm. which is 2 doses a day, mm-hmm. Just keep track exact times each day.
Mm-hmm.
Other than that, obviously there's other factors such as abstaining from certain foods like grapefruit. Some chemicals in that and such can, I guess, interfere with the medicine?
Oh, with the medication. Yeah, a lot of people have that with different medications. So were you able to... Oh, a home viewer. We have a phone call. This is very exciting. Go ahead. They hung up. I'm sorry, I wasn't watching for the sign. I have to be honest, if you want to call back, we'd be very happy to hear from you. I apologize if I didn't see the sign.
One of the things I did want to expound on, because it's a personal experience, being a donor dad of a child that passed, what Dwendy touched on briefly is, it's a very hard time when that happens. And even if you've signed up, the people from the organ donation, from Gift of Life or the other OPO, OPO stands for Organ Procurement Organization, and the country is divided into 58 regions. Each of those regions control that area. That's their job to recover the organs in that area and then make sure they get to somebody who can use them.
Mm-hmm.
But what she said was with my daughter and talking to other families, donor families who have lost a loved one, as tough as it is for them to approach you at that time and ask if you're going to make that donation, the long term, especially year after year after year, the comfort you get that something good happened out of that death.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It is a comfort to the families.
Mm-hmm. Now, were you able to know or connect with any of the recipients?
You can't with tissue. What I was able to do, what they do, they can track it and track certain things, and they were able to say, okay, the corneas went to this city and went to a woman of this age or a man of this age, mm-hmm. and this went to this city. So I got about 20 responses of where, but if you receive an organ, Dwendy could better tell you how the connections are done, but it's very carefully.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So everything is, of course, HIPAA regulations is confidential, mm-hmm. and if a family member wants to find out who the recipients are, how they're doing, or even vice versa, the recipient wants to know more about their donor family, we do have a wonderful department, family support department, that we help with those families. And we do old school. You start out with a letter writing. You know, you write your donor family or your recipient. And, mm-hmm. All of those things, personal things, are whited out. And it's sent on. And then if vice versa, they respond, you know, the communication goes back and forth. Mm-hmm. There's a very small window, but there are times where, you know, the letter will come through, I think I want to meet you. So we help coordinate those meetings, mm-hmm. and but it doesn't happen too often, but it's just nice to know. A lot our donor families often say, just knowing that it is working and someone else is leading a great life since the transplant. Yeah. It's just knowing and just being able to say thank you is the most important thing.
Mm-hmm. You're young. How do you feel? Do you stop and think sometimes what it means for you in your life?
Every now and then, I guess some people see me as an example, mm-hmm. or an inspiration. Sometimes I don't see it as that. And then sometimes that you wonder about people who don't get that second chance or that ability to live the life that they want to. For example, the person I have my heart from, his name is Brian. Mm-hmm. Well, of course, the HIPAA laws there aren't much information
to
find out from them. But
right.
all I know is that his family was from Atlanta, Georgia, and he was 5 years old, died tragically, and I believe in a car crash. Mm-hmm. Not entirely sure, but I know my mom. She did write a letter to the mother, mm-hmm. Like at least a decade ago. And from what I've heard, that she has a picture, well, the mother does, of myself on her work desk.
Oh.
So.
I can only imagine that must mean just the world to her. You know, but I'm sure it was a hard decision. Now, your life, though, people would say, oh, you have a heart transplant, you can't do what other people do. Is that true?
No.
No?
Absolutely not. I mean, throughout high school, I ran track. I was in the 4x100 relay, in the pen relays.
Mm-hmm.
Against my mother's wishes, I ran, played football in middle school. Right now, I have an internship for Senator John Rafferty.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to be in my senior year of college.
Oh, that's great.
And,
where are you going to school?
I'm at LaSalle University right
now. Nice, yeah. So what do you want to do with the rest of your life?
I guess let's just go from there. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm not entirely sure what's going to lead me to, but mm-hmm. We'll just have to see where it goes.
That's exciting. Mm-hmm. And it's a long, long stretch, wide open, mm-hmm. which is pretty awesome. That is great.
I think that when you see the kids like Jake, that's the most exciting. A lot of times you're thinking of older people getting mm-hmm. a transplant that maybe right. lived a lot of their life, but just think the potential that's with Jake that, mm-hmm. that never would have had a chance without that.
That's right.
And one of the things that I always say when I do a lot of speeches to help Dwendy out, and I'm a very strong advocate for this, but I finally say this is all about saving lives, and why would you want to cremate or bury a good organ that could live on in somebody else? All the major religions of the world believe in organ donation. Mm-hmm. There are some small side ones that don't, but all the major ones do. all the Christianity, Islam, Judaism, and there's other ones too that are major religions that do. They all look at it that it's one of the best gifts you can give. Mm-hmm. So please don't waste that. Don't waste that organ. Hopefully you'll never have to. We don't want you to die. But there's those out there too that if you really feel like it, you can be a living donor with a kidney or a portion of your liver, if you're in shape, and that's something mm-hmm. you want to do. But that's something, mm-hmm. you know.
And I think, too, the biggest thing is keeping in mind that we can register very easily. Mm-hmm. When we go, if we're old enough and we have our state ID or our driver's license, when you go to the driver's license center, you can just hit that check off yes.
Yeah.
I know that we don't get our license renewed for every 4 years. We may inspire someone today to register,
yeah.
and you're able to go onto the Department of Pennsylvania website or donors1.org and be able to register in less than 30 seconds.
Yeah. So
donor1.org.
Donors1.org.
Right. I think we have, if there's time, if somebody can just take a little shot of this little bottom, there is also an 877 number.
And that is actually Jake on there.
That is Jake on that poster. Yeah.
We are actually doing a wonderful partnership with the community health centers to help raise awareness about the need for organ donations.
Yeah.
So these are our posters that we have, and Jake is part of our call to action.
Yeah. We have been able to tell some wonderful stories over the years, and we're going to keep on doing it. This half hour, I told you it would fly by, and it really does.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for being here. It's such an important story. We hope at least one person is inspired, and I hope fewer people have to be on that waiting list.
Exactly.
So thank you for being with us on Berks Community Health Center Presents. We will be back next month, the second Tuesday at 7 p.m. is our new time. So thanks for being with us.
Berks Community Health Center Presents on BCTV is supported by the Berks Community Health Center.